I do not say ekatantaya vitmahe vakratundaya timahi tanno tanji prajodayat without starting my day. Since we have had the finally, I think it's quite heartening to finally debate a bill in this house. It's been a long time since we have had the opportunity to debate the bill, and I'd like to first thank my party president Mrs. Sonia Gandhi for giving me the opportunity to be the first speaker in this session on a bill. Sir, while we have over a billion people in India, and we always consider that India to be an overpopulated country, there are many people who are unable to have children and who find the benefit from the assisted reproductive technologies. So it is essential that this technology is available to all, and it is also regulated and may ensure that best medical practices are followed while this technology is made available to all. Sir, indulge me a little bit. I am a great admirer of our Puranams, Itihasams and epics. I grew up reading Amar Chitra Kada. I don't even know whether Amar Chitra Kada is still around or not, but I grew up reading Amar Chitra Kada.
It is around.
My maternal grandmother, when I was growing up, told me many fables and stories. Sir, this is a government which professes to draw inspiration from our Puranas and from our Itihasams and from our epics. Government ministers have spoken about Pushpak Vimana. I've asked even research to be done on the existence of the Pushpak Vimana and the science behind it. The Prime Minister has alluded to Ganesha when he was addressing a conference of doctors in 2014. Sir, I come from Shivaganga. Pillayarpatti is the biggest temple there and the most famous temple there. And we are all great devotees of Ganesha. In fact, there is not a single day goes by where I do not say ekatantaya vitmahe vakratundaya timahi tanno tanji prajodayat without starting my day. But the Prime Minister, when he spoke to the doctors, said that evidence of plastic surgery was there because Ganesha has an elephant head which was fitted to a human being. It's a different matter, and I've always wondered how a circumference of an elephant head can be fitted to a human. But still, we draw inspiration from our Puranas. Sir, our epics have so many instances of unconventional births. Our entire epics, we read the Mahabharata, is the starting point of that. You look at the Kuru dynasty of the Kauravas. Dhritarashtra and Gandhari could not have children. In fact, the legend is that the entire Kuru princes, the 100 of them from Duryodhana, who's actually called Suyodhana. In fact, we must have a debate why Duryodhana's name is not called as Suyodhana, which his real name is Suyodhana. In fact, somebody must explain this to me at some point of time. 100 of them were born on earthen pots. We always believe that this is the beginning of the test tube baby, perhaps came from the inspiration from this. This is what your government believes. Your government always draws inspiration from epics. The Pandavas, again, you know that King Pandu was cursed by Durvasa. He could not have children through Kunti or Madri. In fact, Kunti had to evoke the gods to have children. That system was called Niyoge. Surya was the father of Karna. Karma was fathered by Yama. Arjuna was fathered by Indra. Bhima was fathered by Vayu. And Nakula and Sakadeva were fathered by the Ashwini twins. So the system of Niyoga was there in those days. And sir, in Kerala, the most revered god Ayappa, he is said to have been born between the union of Shiva and Vishnu. That is why he is called Hariharasudar. And in Tamil Nadu, the most revered god is Muruga. In fact, my parents have named me after the same god. Karthi is one more name for Muruga. And he was born from the Netrikan, which is the third eye of Shiva, only from Shiva. So our Puranas have unconventional births are mentioned in our Puranas throughout. This government always says it draws inspiration from these Puranas. But sir, this law which they have drafted is not inspired by the liberal Hindu epics. In fact, this law has been drafted by somebody who's got a regressive colonial Victorian mindset. Please keep that in mind. It is not from the Hindu liberal traditions this law has come. This law has come from the completely regressive Victorian colonial mindset. I will tell you why. Sir, this law excludes many people rather than includes them. See, when I have given you so many instances of unconventional births, unconventional unions in our Hindu epics, this law only allows married people to have access to this technology. It does not allow LGBTQ people to have access to this technology. This does not allow single men to have access to this technology. So this law is actually a Victorian law. It is not a Hindu law. But don't ever say you are a government which is actually propagating Hindu values. If Hindu values are there, it's a liberal value. You are in fact propagating a Victorian colonial value.
Sir,
Hindi enakku theriyadupa annikku annikku theriyilla innikku enakku endhi theriyadu. Sir, this law does not take into account the new realities of India. These new realities are not new realities. These are from our ancient scriptures. Those unions which are there, which were always there, which were suppressed by the colonial mentality, these unions will also be given access to these technologies. LGBTQ population, live-in couples, single men must also have access to this technology if they choose to be fathers. Sir, this law is discriminatory. This law violates Article 14 of the Constitution, as well as the Puttasamy judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. The liberty of procreation and choice of family life are an intrinsic aspect of fundamental right to privacy. Every individual who is mentally and physically fit to be a parent and financially able to do must be able to avail these technologies, and you cannot discriminate people by the lifestyle choices they make and deny them access to this technology. Sir, this law again is patriarchal. That is even a hallmark of this government and the hallmark of all it says. The person who is capable of donating an egg has to be married, has to have had a child who is at least 3 years old, only then can become a donor. A single woman cannot become a donor. Again, they are taking, this is reeks of patriarchy. According to this government, unless a woman fulfills the role of becoming a mother in an established union, she cannot become a donor. This is again shameful. This is again goes away. You take away the right of an individual to decide how they want to choose to be a donor or not. This again has to be looked at. The minister needs to address this issue. He needs to definitely give an answer on why only married women who have had a child and that child has to be 3 years old, only then they can be a donor of the egg. Sir, there is also something which is very troubling. This law says that you can send the embryo to determine any pre-existing deficiencies. This is very problematic because you are not defining what these pre-existing heritable life-threatening genetic diseases are. This almost borders on eugenics, where you want to do selection, where you want to decide what kind of children can be born and what kind of children cannot be born. So the minister must definitely address this issue and address why these specific diseases which they want to prevent is not defined and left a very gaping hole there. Sir, another thing, sir, the surrogacy bill was passed in this house without debate, but the surrogacy bill is still pending in the Raj Sabha. So it has not yet become law. But this bill says there is going to be an oversight board which draws its power from the Surrogacy Act. So why are they bringing this bill when that bill has not become law? There are many conflicts between these two laws. Why do you need to have two bills? Why could both not be combined? The surrogacy bill says you must keep records for 25 years. This bill says you keep records only for 10 years. Again, the oversight board is only through the surrogacy bill. Here, the surrogacy bill has not become an act as yet. So how are you going to establish the board where you are drawing the powers from that act which is not there? So there is a lot of conflict. The minister must definitely address why was the haste in bringing this bill when that bill has not been passed, and why is the need to have two separate bills instead of having one combined bill which deal with the subject, pretty much the same subject. Sir, another issue which has not been addressed, which could be problematic, it's a very sensitive issue. A child born through a donor after the age of 18 might be curious to find out who the father is. That right is not given here today. And I accept that there is a privacy right of the donor. So there must be some sensitivity in this. And in the ICMR suggests that the characteristics of the donor must be told to the child. Or the identity, of course, cannot be given because most donors are anonymous. So that sensitivity is not being handled in this bill, and the minister must definitely address to find out how are you going to handle this sensitivity. It's a very sensitive subject, I accept. There's no politics in it. It's a very sensitive subject and they must deal with it. As far as the complaint mechanism goes, unless only the board can complain, an individual cannot complain. So you are really taking away the fundamental right of a person from going to court. Only the board can go to court and not the individual. Again, this is very problematic. You can't take away a fundamental right of a person for the right to go to court. And again, the board is only established by the Surrogacy Act, and the Surrogacy Act is still not established. So that is another lacuna which you must address. Sir, you want the Aadhaar card for the donor because you want to identify the donor with the Aadhaar card. But the donor has to be anonymous. What if there is a leak of data? What are we doing to protect that? Because a lot of people are donors, but they do not want their identity to be there because they have no legal right over the child. And it's also another thing. So lots of issues of privacy, lots of issues of fundamental rights, lots of issues of discrimination are very much there, and we must take it there. Sir, while the clinics are not regulated, they are becoming commercial establishments. The minister knows that IVF is a very, very expensive procedure. Many people go through many cycles before they have any success in it. It's a very expensive procedure. There is no control over their pricing. There is no control over how these clinics are established. But you prohibit the donors from charging anything because you do not want commercial exploitation of that. There is a lot of merit in that, but there must be some balance. While you are not regulating the practice, the medical practice, you are completely regulating the surrogacy part of it. So there must be some balance between it, and there must be some clarity between it. Another thing which it does not address is, this is a very expensive procedure. But many people of all strata of society want to have children of their own. What is the provision for them who do not have money? Is there any program which the government is proposing by which people who do not have the resources can also access this technology? This technology cannot be only available to the rich. This technology must be available to everybody who wants to have children, and that is a fundamental that should be accessible to all. So the government must definitely address this issue as well. Sir, as I said in the beginning, this is a government which always says it draws inspiration from our Puranas. But this government is not at all acting in the way in which I have been taught Hindutva by my grandmother. This government is a Victorian colonial government, and it is acts like that. Every act of this government is colonial. And this bill is also a colonial bill, and not a bill which is true to our faith, which is liberal, which accommodates everybody, looks at different kinds of relationships, and looks at all kinds of things, which is an all-encompassing philosophy. That all-encompassing philosophy has always been lacking in this government, and this bill is yet another example of that. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hina Gavitji.